you guys, this is Good Deeds, and I'm Dr. Renee Sunday. We're hanging out still at the Super Bowl weekend. We actually have the awesome opportunity of being here at the Super Bowl breakfast, where BART Star Award is being presented. It's so amazing. It's at least 800 people here. We actually have a amazing lineup. You know, the thing to do is let your friends, family know, just sit back and relax, and we're going to actually bring this to you. You know, we love you. This is Good Deeds, and I'm Dr. Renee Sunday.
So for Hunt and their families are people of profound influence, and influence is what this event has been about for some 30 years now. As a matter of fact, no honor in the NFL is more highly regarded than the BART Star Award. And receiving this honor has brought some of the toughest men in our game to tears. I'm trying to prime Jackie on that. I'm hoping, like the Dickens, I get to see Big Jackie tear up when he talks about his son. The rich history of the BART Star Award includes 12 members of the Pro Football Hall of Fame, with one other who may be inducted tonight, and at least 7 others who should join them in the future. But this award is unique because it is not just about excellence, as Coach Dungy would always say, on the field. It's about leadership, character, integrity, and influence, all of the hallmarks of the man for which it is named. In addition, you may not know that what else makes this award so special is that it is the recipient who was selected by a vote of his peers. This morning, we have the great privilege to speak with some of the past recipients of this award. You saw them earlier by video, and now you get an opportunity to hear them live. I'd like to ask them to join me here on the stage. Up first, Anthony Munoz, widely considered, and Jackie, so yeah, I didn't write this, Jackie, widely considered the greatest offensive lineman in the NFL history. He was inducted into the Pro Football Hall of Fame in 1998, an 11-time Pro Bowler, 9-time All-Pro, and 3-time Lineman of the Year. He received the BART Star Award in 1990, the second recipient of the award. That is Mr. Anthony Munoz. Boy, television cameras love focusing on this guy, Mike Singletary, one of the greatest linebackers ever. It's a 10-time All-Pro, a Pro Bowl selection, 9-time All-Pro, 2-time Defensive Player of the Year. He helped lead the Bears to a championship in Super Bowl 20 and was inducted into the Hall of Fame in 1998. He received the BART Star Award in 1991. Mike Singletary. Bill Bird, a standout defensive back from the San Diego Chargers. He was a 2-time Pro Bowler and a 4-time All-Pro, was inducted into the Chargers Hall of Fame in 1998. Please welcome Gil Bird. Love this guy because he spent a whole lot of time working with me to understand the subtleties of the game. Aeneas Williams, an 8-time Pro Bowler, 4-time All-Pro defensive back. He was inducted into the Pro Football Hall of Fame in 2004. It is Pastor Aeneas Williams. Bruce Matthews, talk about a granite block, a fan favorite here in Houston. He was inducted into the Hall of Fame in 2007, was a 14-time Pro Bowler and 10-time All-Pro. He was the BART Star Award winner in 2001, Mr. Bruce Matthews. Coach Dungy has a smile on his face because this guy epitomized the best on and off the field. Derrick Brooks, inducted into the Hall in 2014, an 11-time Pro Bowler, a 9-time All-Pro, was a Defensive Player of the Year in 2002, received the BART Star Award here in Houston, has a huge heart for kids, Mr. Derrick Brooks. Added to the front office of the NFL, one of the most influential executives around, Troy Benson, a 5-time Pro Bowler, 3-time All-Pro. He was inducted into the Eagles Hall of Fame in 2012, now serves as the Executive Vice President of Football Operations for the league. He received the award in 2005, Mr. Troy Benson. And finally, a guy who looks like he can still go at it now. He's wearing the same suits in terms of being able to fit them that he did in high school, something I certainly envy quite a bit. Curtis Martin, inducted into the Hall of Fame in 2012. He remains the 4th leading rusher in NFL history, a 5-time Pro Bowler and a 2-time All-Pro. He received the BART Star Award in 2006. Gentlemen, we are honored to have you this morning. A round of applause for this outstanding. All right, since I'm not in the studio having to rehearse this, I'm going to need my producer, Steve Rich, to stay in my ear as we talk about this with all of these outstanding players. Anthony Munoz, you're going into Anthony? Man, the buddy does not move at all. All right. So, first of all, let's talk a little bit about your favorite Super Bowl memory, Anthony Munoz.
We have to bring it up, huh?
You know what? As a matter of fact, let me move over here while you talk about that, because I don't want to upset you.
No. I had a couple of great memories. We played in 16 and 23, although we did not win. I still have nightmares about what number 16, Joe Montana. So as long as you don't, well, I already did bring him up, I'm fine. But no, it was amazing. You know, as a member of the Cincinnati Bengals, you get into the NFL and you start working the offseason, the preseason, the regular season, and that's the goal, is to make the playoffs and then to hopefully go to a Super Bowl. And, you know, going to the Bengals from the University of Southern California and being able to experience that my second year in the league, well, was phenomenal. And to play up in Pontiac, the first one, and then Miami, the second one. I'm thankful that I had the opportunity to experience two Super Bowls. It would have been nice to at least win one, but I can say that I played in a couple.
For sure. All right, Mr. Mike Singletary, I talked about how the cameras loved focusing on you because there was nobody more intense. As a matter of fact, the Christian motivational speaker, Zig Ziglar, talked an awful lot about you as well, too, how he defied all of the statistics as scouts were trying to grade. They just didn't understand the size of the heart in this guy. Your Super Bowl memories.
I think the stage was set the night before the game. Buddy Ryan got up and did not have a lot to say that night. He looked at all of the guys, and of course we were ready to go, and we were just leaning in to hear what he had to say. And he got teary-eyed and just said, his bottom lip started shaking a little bit, quivering. And he just said, guys, all of you will always be my heroes. And he walked out of the room. And we sat there in the defensive, on the defensive side of the ball, and just kind of looked at each other. And Dan Hampton got up and slapped the projector on the floor, and Steve McMichael threw a chair through the wall. I don't remember anything else. I just knew it was going to be a pretty decent game the next day.
They were channeling that energy. And you know what, as I ask Derek about his Super Bowl memory, again, I think about the kind of people that Coach helped to mold. I know it started at the home. And Derek, I'll never forget the story when you were saying on your day off, you went to a local Boys and Girls Club, something like that, and you were talking to the kid, and when they looked up, you know, they were talking about an airplane or something, and you realized that they had never been on an airplane. I'm sure I butchered the story up, but talk about that as it relates to what you also accomplished on the field.
Well, for me, I had the blessing of having Coach Dungy as my head coach for my second year in the league. And Coach's first speech to our team was not about winning football games on the field. He talked about if we as an organization doesn't win the community, we always lose. And we went out to practice. Well, that wasn't a very popular speech to a franchise that's coming off 12 years of double-digit losing seasons. So we're like, what is this guy talking about? So it intrigued me so much, I met with Coach after practice, and I said, Coach, you know, I'm really, you know, puzzled why you didn't talk about winning games. You know, the team is like, well, dude, is the right guy here before us? And he said, no, Derek, we are. He said, you got to understand, in life, it's about winning. The game of football will take care of itself. If we do the right things in the community, we all gonna win, and football will take its place. So it was with that fabric that I started my Brooks Bunch program, and the story that James is referring to is on Tuesdays, I went and visited local Boys and Girls Clubs in this particular club in the inner city, where the conditions wasn't, you know, let's just say they had their moments. Well, while we played the Green Bay Packers that Sunday, and I was over there that Monday night, and a young lady by the name of Natasha Spencer came in, and she saw me, she came up, and she said, "How'd you get back from the game? I was just watching you guys play. I'm sorry you guys lost, and, you know, don't worry about it. You'll get them next week." I said, "Thank you. I appreciate it, Natasha." She said, "Well, how'd you guys drive back so fast?" Man, I said, "We flew on an airplane." I said, "After the game, we get on the airplane, we fly back." I said, "Haven't you seen an airplane?" I said, they fly over here to get to the airport." And she looked at me and she said, "Derek, I don't look up when I'm leaving here. I look straight ahead because I don't want to get shot running home." And that just touched my heart, that the idea of she was afraid to look up and even couldn't even experience what an airplane is. And then I realized that I didn't even have an opportunity to fly an airplane until I was recruited in high school. So it spurred me to really give kids an experience that they've never experienced before, and that's when I decided to take a group of those kids on their first airplane trip, and I prayed a lot about it. And God said, "Be careful what you ask for." So I flew about 45 kids from that center. We took a quick day trip down to Fort Lauderdale, Florida from Tampa. And coming back on that trip, which really is still ingrained in me today, is the fact that a lot of those kids came up to me and told me that was the best day of their life because they knew that they were going to live. And again, thank you guys. So that's the fact that the brothers and sisters.
Since Derek has started down that track, I remember Bill Bradley wrote a book back in the day called Values of the Game. Talk about what the game has taught you, experiences or lessons that have carried over so effectively in the game and in life.
Great question, thank you, Jen. I appreciate that. For me, it's easy what the game has taught me. It's taught me to be faithful to the task at hand, to be there for my fellow brother. It's taught me to be available to the calling in my life. And it's taught me to be teachable, to never think that I know it all, but to always learn and grow in this journey of life. The game has been good. It's taught me some great, great lessons in life, how to be a father, and most importantly, how to be a husband. And the best man I can show my sons is to be a great husband. And that's the best thing I can do for my children. I love to see men discipling and mentoring men.
Let me coach on that and go right to the next to the fellow next to you. I know we so often lionize, if you will, big guys, Bruce and Anthony as well too, but to show what a real man is all about. And I mean, I was impressed to know that not only are you a man of faith, but character and integrity. Talk about the game and what that's done for you as you've carried over into the game of life as well.
Well, first, are there any old Oilers fans out here?
I just wanted to get that in.
No, I agree 100% with Gil. Getting knocked down on your rear in football in terms of how you respond to that, it's just like life. It's what everyone deals with, not just NFL players. I mean, we're either in the midst of something or we're fixing to be dealing with something. And the same holds true playing this great game and the ability to get along with your teammates. We're all from different backgrounds, different upbringings. And to put yourself and of the same mind, of one accord, put that common goal in front of you, I think has taught my family so much, and it's something I think that all of us have tried to pass on to the next generation, and it's just an amazing game.
The last three guys I want to touch on, Aeneas Williams, and I know when I was doing play-by-play, again, not having played the game of football, despite the size and girth, Corwin, that I think I used to have anyway, and I'll get to that later. Aeneas is truly a guy who reflects character and integrity throughout. And as I mentioned, he is now a pastor working in the hood as well, too. Why?
Well, first, James, I want to make sure these guys know that you know, I don't know if you insulted us in on purpose. Did anybody notice that Curtis was the only one he said looked like he could still play and was fitting his suit? So I just want to get the guys riled up to make sure.
Listen well, baby.
I want that suit.
Let me move away from Anthony while he's saying that. Okay, go ahead.
I want to make sure. You know, we football fans, all right?
But the first part, and this will kind of bring you to tears because many may not know the story, but what. So my wife Tracy and I have been married 24 years, but it first starts out with the power of mentorship. There's a scripture that's 1 Corinthians, I think it's 15:33, where it says, evil communication corrupts good manners. In other words, your environment will change you before you change it. And I remember God put it in my heart, so many believers have goals, but they never write them down. And they don't realize that there's a mentor. Mentors, credible, successful others, who've done well what you're trying to do. There's no need to reinvent the wheel. It's already been done. So my second year in the league, I wanted to be, I'd already written about it, I wanted to be one of the best to ever play the game. I had given my life to Christ, I was committed to Christ. But the practical steps on, how do you actualize the potential that's in you? And it was maybe my second year, we played the San Diego Chargers. And there was a guy, Bobby Jackson, one of our coaches on the Arizona Cardinals staff, that kept telling me about this guy named Gil Bird, who was playing for the San Diego Chargers and was 2 years ahead of me. And I want to say this to all the young people, because the difference in your life are the people that impact your life and that give you the ability to believe you can do something that you're not sure you can do. So after we played the San Diego Chargers, I befriended Gil Bird. I said, Mr. Bird, can I get your phone? And called him up after the season, and he and his wife, Marilyn, so graciously said, come out to San Diego. And he took me to the Chargers facilities. He sat down, taught me how to study film. He said, the things I'm going to teach you is going to cause the game to slow down. I said, what are you talking about, Mr. Bird? This game is fast. He taught me how to read the quarterback in zone and in man. He allowed Tracy and I, he and Marilyn, to come stay in their home. Matter of fact, full disclosure, my oldest two were conceived in the house, all right? he didn't know this, all right? All of us are a product of that. I'm not saying anything different. I just want the young people. We have our parents. My parents are outstanding. But when it comes down to you specializing and finding that passion that's in your life, you have to connect with people. And humility is shown through reach. He was shocked that I called him. But we went out every offseason, and it was a game changer on and off the field. Because not only to be great on the field, but to be great men that love your wives, and sincerely learn how to do it, because more is caught than taught. And for Gil and Marilyn, and I can't thank you enough publicly, to know the impact you had on my life, and now the legacy of so many guys who the Lord has allowed Trace and I to impact their lives. So thank you for allowing me to share this story.
Wow. The shallow world of sports broadcasting, that we focus only on the on-field exploits and heroics, when there's a lot deeper meaning. And we thank you for being so transparent in sharing that as well, and show that a man can express his emotions and talk about deeply what another guy did. Relationship, again, is that theme. Let me give 30, 45 seconds each. You said I dissed you guys in talking about Curtis Martin. Maybe it was because I just envy the fact that he's like a size 12 with his suits, you know, and can still wear those things. Curtis, you go in any direction that you want. I shared with when we were over in Israel on what was an outstanding cathartic trip for me and my wife from any number of standpoints, spiritually for sure. Just take it anywhere you go and what it means to be a Barnstar Award winner.
Well, you know, I was thinking that I would speak on what football has done for me. I come from a very horrible background, so I grew up without a positive male role model in my life. I grew up without discipline. And I think if I was to say the main lesson that football taught me was discipline. I have a quote that says, discipline is the bridge between thought and accomplishment. It's what takes you from inspiration to achievement. And through the NFL, through the discipline that I learned in the NFL, it has positioned me not only to better my life, but to better all the lives around me, and then beyond that. My pastor wrote a book, and this is something I think that my wife would agree with. There are four things that he says a woman wants from a man. Maturity, consistency, decisiveness, and strength. Maturity, consistency, decisiveness, and strength. Those are the things that football taught me. They instilled those things in me so strong that even though I had a very abusive, unbelievably like crazy household, I'm so grateful because it's only the Lord's work in my heart that has allowed me to exhibit those things in my household today and be a good man, not just for my wife, but for my two little daughters. Wow.
Here is Troy Vincent, who was an elite level player in the National Football League, a businessman with at least two very successful businesses, one being in the financial services arena as well, worked with the NFL Players Association in an executive position, and now is the highest ranking African-American, but just an influential executive in the league, period, setting the example, modeling the leadership. Troy, talk about what it's meant to you to go from the field to the boardroom and your responsibility as such.
If I can I pivot? And I just think that when I hear the men talk about their faith is awesome. I didn't have the opportunity to play in the Super Bowl, and quite frankly, never was the goal. So for 15 years, I played with three phenomenal teammates, James Drash, Brian Dawkins, and I'm gonna say myself. The number one goal week in and week out was to bring people to Christ, whether that was a coach or a player. So every single day of practice, every single day, or every Sunday, Monday, and Thursday, we had a pack. Today, we're gonna use our body as a living sacrifice. Somebody's watching. We're gonna be an example. Coach used to allow us to have, we're going to say, of these 32 teams, no one will bring more people to Christ than the Philadelphia Eagles. That was a pack. It was almost Coach Reed, Jeffrey Lurie. They allowed, we did Bible study four nights a week. Every Sunday, we wasn't leaving the stadiums. We were bringing people to the unfiltered word of God. That's coaches, that's players on the opposite team, that's the homeless leaving out of the stadium. That's what it was always with. It was always about that. And having that platform, and it doesn't change from a player. When you come into my office at 345 Park Avenue, it's all a setup. Yeah, we can talk about key performance indicators, we can talk about gate and fan engagement. But as you talk to me, you're looking at my Bible open in scriptures on the file cabinets. I have scriptures all around. Because eventually, once you shut that door, we're going to talk about the love, the unfiltered love that Christ has for us. Christ loves me just as much as he loves you. So that's really what it was all about. So when I hear the young men share their testimonies and what the game of football has done, it's never about the wins and losses on Sunday. It's always about, we all gonna come to the game, and we're all gonna have to answer that question. What have you done for the least of them? That's the ultimate goal. And learning how to lead from behind, and just bringing people to Christ. So, I hope it was okay for me to pivot there. I had the opportunity in Madison, Wisconsin, to look at Bart and hear Bart Starr's name every single day for 4 years in Madison. So I knew what excellence was. We weren't a very good football team, but you had the Packers a few years away. So Coach Morton, then Coach Alvarez, came in, and he gave us an example of what excellence was. So as a 19, 20, 21-year-old, I saw excellence in Bart because I was a product of a Madison, Wisconsin student athlete. So I saw excellence.
So that provides the segue for the final 5 or 10 seconds per. Troy has already started it with what the Bart Starr Award meant to him. Curtis, and then we'll pick up with Bruce and come around the horn. The Bart Starr, you want to get to the others? As I said, Curtis wanted to squish it around the room to somebody else.
Yeah.
We'll come back in. Mr. Matthews.
Yes, thank you. Man, Bart Starr represented what is great about the NFL to me, growing up as a fan of the league, growing up in a football family. But the biggest thing I've taken from that, from when I received the award and what I received today, is inspiration and encouragement. And that's to know Jesus more and to make him known. And man, what an awesome morning.
For me, it's not about me. What I've taken from this award is it's not about me individually. It's about giving, it's about serving, it's about being a reflection of Christ.
We stand on the shoulders of those that have come before us, Bart Starr being one of the guys as a believer, as a Christian, that when his life early on, which all of us subsequently, we had a light early in the professional game. But what comes to mind when it comes to the Bart Starr Award is it's already implied that Bart didn't complete every pass. And many times what I think about this award in terms of Christian character is Christians don't fail, they mishandle mistakes made. So what I had to learn as a cornerback is to forgive a bad play. What Bart had to do as a quarterback is forget a bad play or misread. And what Jesus Christ has done for each and every one of us is to give us the ability that we didn't get it right. There's a lot we did wrong. But the willingness to not quit, ask for forgiveness, and keep moving as if we've never messed up is a reminder of what these awards are about. Not perfect people standing here, but people who've decided not to quit when it didn't go so well, when you lost a Super Bowl, like I did. To Tom Brady in the early on, his first Super Bowl, right? But to now get down on your knees and not become bitter, but get better and worship God after the loss like you would have done if you had won the game.